ICR, IRA, IRA he has got, and he is also working in PUSA IRA. He has got a master's award certificate from IIM Lucknow, and he has got about 100 papers published. He has guided 20 MTech students, and he has also worked with projects funded with the DST, World Bank, ICR, CPI. And he has got, given 50 live recorded programs on national Doordarshan, all these channels. He has been to, as well as he's worked, as well as he got acknowledgements from Marshall, that is from Israel, and Novadeydes Agricolas from Spain for the work he has done in protective cultivation, drip irrigation in IRI. He has been recently involved as technical expert and member of DST, TIFAC GOI, National Water Mission, Ministry of Water Resources, and Bureau of Indian Standards, National Horticultural Board. He is also a member of ISAE and Indian Society of Water Management and Indian Society of Protective Cultivation. He has 21 years experience of teaching, and we already know him already in this group. So he has been dedicated for the protective cultivation. The floor is yours, Dr. Murtaza.
Thank you, Dr. Ismail sir. Respected Gajendra Singh sir, Dr. Tiwari sir, Indramani sir, Ajay Singh sahab, my colleagues speaker today, Dr. Sandeep Jain, and other colleagues from ICR, from SAUs, and also from Indian Society of Agriculture Engineers, and one very important attendees today, and he shall speak today also, one very professional farmer, Mr. Sunil Sharma from Alwar, Rajasthan. I welcome you all. It's really a privilege to talk on the topic that is related to protected cultivation, and then it is very much related to urban agriculture also, and then very concerted efforts have been going on to promote this technology from government sides, from entrepreneur sides, from different bodies also now. So now, first I will share my screen and then start the presentation. I hope the slide is now visible to all. The first slide.
Yes. Yes. Okay. Go ahead, please.
Okay. So the topic is today is that is the protected cultivation technology research and initiatives. So this is the picture from the place where I am working at present. That is the Center for Protected Cultivation Technology. It is located at IERI, and our farm, especially that is 25 acre farms where we are doing all the concerted efforts towards the main focus that is on protected cultivation technology. Coming to the first slides, that is the topic that is the protected cultivation of horticulture crops. In brief, what it is all about. So first that, what I could understand it, that this technology particularly, it's a very good, you can say mixture or amalgamation of engineering, agriculture, and automation. And nowadays there is a word that is the controlled environment agriculture. It's a very common words now being used by different funding agencies, specialists, and many foreign institutes also, where lots of courses going on related to this controlled environment agriculture. So protected cultivation is very much related to it. And then we have been listening about one of the type of farming, that is the precision farming that we say, where we apply all the inputs in right time, right place, and right amount. So I think this technology certainly deals with it. Then one of the common thing is that why we at present need this technology, especially in a country like India. You see now that nowadays, lots of biotic and abiotic stresses are prevalent in almost now every part of the country, mainly due to the climate change. Lots of changes due to the climatic factors that comes under the abiotic stress. And we can now see that what is happening now. We have extreme events like flood, drought, very high rain in very less time. So these are all comes under the abiotic stress. And then as a engineers, we deal with this abiotic stress. But biotic stress is also very important, because now in IRI, when we are working with the team, with the all the scientists related to plant protection group and pathology, entomology, and nematology, what they are saying that there is also now so many biotic stress nowadays prevalent. So many diseases are coming, that very complex diseases are coming and affecting the crops. So these things are very important nowadays. So overall, if we do the protected cultivation technology properly, then we can certainly deal with biotic and abiotic stress. It's not that in protected cultivation, we can totally get rid of 100% all the stresses, but we can certainly control the factors. Then another very important point is that we have been working on lots of aspects like automation, IoT, and sensors, which clearly shows us through the research that when we use this type of modern tools, it helps in ultimately increasing the production, then decreasing the energy part, better management, and also saving of inputs. Then, especially in northern India, it is very difficult to have the round-the-year cultivation. There is a, we have extreme summer, we have extreme winter also. So in these of in modes, especially how to do the round-the-year cultivation possible. So protected cultivation also helps in these facts. There are lots of examples of protected cultivation like greenhouse, net house. These are the words that we listen very, very commonly in presentations. Nursery, tunnels, shade net, shelters. I will show these structures in the in my subsequent slides. Then what we could found that when we use this type of technology, there is a lot of saving of water and nutrient through the use of water harvesting, drip fertigation, other modern irrigation tools and fertigation tools, which could be, which is possible through the protected cultivation. And now some very advanced module of protected cultivation in the form of vertical farming, in the say like soilless, hydroponics and aeroponics nowadays, these are the tools, and you can say the latest advanced or advanced modules of protected cultivation, in which now many universities, IITs, NIITs, and the state agriculture university, now they are working. This slide I included that because this technology is now, it does also have been using for entrepreneurship development. So there are few technology that we have tried so far at, and it had, they have been tried by different ICR institutes also, that naturally ventilated greenhouse, or almost you can say zero energy model greenhouse with low pressure drip fertigation. So this is one of the models particularly used by Indian farmers in remote conditions. Then plug tray nursery raising technology, in which in the greenhouse, we do not do the crop production, but we actually raise the nursery and sell the seedlings. This technology particularly, we have found it is very popular for entrepreneurship development. Then we have modified different protected structures and grow different horticulture crops as per the need of the farmer, as per the need of the particular area, as per the agroclimatic regions. And then it has also been found good technology for entrepreneurship development. And then now presently, these advanced protected cultivation modules, as I discussed in the last slide, many entrepreneurs and the professionals, they are coming and for entrepreneurship development, having the background, mostly I found in engineering, in management, and also defense sectors. Many in defense, many persons are getting retired very early and they want to do some modern cultivation, especially now the peri-urban cultivation, you can say, in the form of vertical farming, whether it is soilless, hydroponics and aeroponics. Many entrepreneurs are coming to us, and then we are trying to help us through our institute, through our center for potato cultivation technology. I could find some reference that worldwide, what is the major, the countries having the greenhouse production, although it's slightly old data, but 2016 data says that you can see that China almost 28 lakh hectares. Now it is almost around 50 lakh hectares. Korea, Spain, Japan, Turkey. At that time, 2016-17, in India, it was almost only about 30,000 hectares. But now I will show you the in the next slide, the present data also. The Italy, so these are the few countries where mostly you can say that China is leading. Spain is also doing very good work. And then other many other countries, they are, you can say, pioneer in this type of technology and doing lots of protected cultivation. The Indian scenarios, as I told you, that relatively it's a new technology, and then the total area covered around 2016-17 was 30,000 hectares. The leading states, Maharashtra, Karnataka, Himachal, Northeastern State, Uttarakhand, Tamil Nadu, and Punjab. But nowadays, lots of cultivation have been going on in northern part of India. Eastern part of India is also coming up. Unfortunately, the crops covered in the protected cultivation are very limited. Almost around 10 to 12 crops, mostly the high-value horticulture crops, whether it is in the vegetable side, very popular crops are cucumber, tomato, cherry tomato, capsicum, melons. Now lots of greens like lettuce and all the green herbs, they are the new crops. And in the flower sector, we have rose, gerbera, carnation, chrysanthemum. They are the most popular crop, and then few of them are also there. And lots of government policies are going on to promote this technology, especially in the form of National Horticulture Mission, National Horticulture Board, RKVY, and then MIDH, through which the schemes related to subsidies have been popularized, and then they are being popularized throughout the country. And then many farmers are using this type of technology. NHM, RKVY, they are used mostly for small farmers, small projects. NHB, they are funding very big projects in the mainly in the area of, you can say, in the tune of about more than 1 crore, National Horticulture Board. So this is roughly the Indian scenario. As I told you that now, broadly it comes under the controlled environment agriculture. And you can see if you see the data of 2021, there is a sudden jump, and you can say now the data says that approximately 1 lakh hectare has been reported of protected cultivation area. So there is a drastic improvement, and you can say increase in the area of protected cultivation area coverage. And many farmers are now coming to it and adopting it, which shows that the schemes and the technology is reaching to the farmers. You can see that in the picture, these are the broadly the structures that are being very commonly used by Indian farmers. Naturally ventilated greenhouse, in which there is no energy gadget. Most of this this particular greenhouse is almost zero energy model. Then we have semi-climate type greenhouse, in which we do mostly cooling that is required in India, because in India, most of the part, summer is acute. And for the greenhouse climate, the Indian cold climate, where the temperature is less than 0 degree, higher than 0 degree centigrade, is not a problematic. Once the temperature goes below 0 degree centigrade, then only we need heating. Otherwise, if the temperature is around 0 degree centigrade, we do not need heating in the greenhouse, even in the what we have experienced at IRI also. Then climate controlled nursery, there are tunnels are there, insect proof net house is there. And you can see that this structure, as I have discussed, that it's a structure which has to be designed properly by engineering principles, and the principles are mainly the height, the other very important principle is this ventilation required, what are the crops to be grown, what are the covering materials required, and mostly we use the galvanized iron pipes inside to construct the greenhouse. There are various standard designs of greenhouse and its roof type. So these are all very typical engineering structures in which lots of engineering initiatives are required still to improve the things structure. And then other important thing for this type of structure is very specialized covering material. Specialized plastics, it should be UV stabilized, having should have particular thickness, nets, lots of insect proof net, shade net, silver net, black nets. So these are the covering materials which are very important things required for the design and installation of this particular structures. So some structure, most of these structure are a combination of plastics and nets, but in some structures we use only nets, suppose in insect proof net, it's a shade net in which we use only shade net. So each structure has its typical use for some particular condition to grow particular crops. At IERI, these are the facilities that have been developed for the last about 20 years. That the centers, we have about 20 greenhouse now. Many crops we are using. Almost all the types of protected structures we have. Then major focus research areas now we are either production and protection technologies, IPM and GAP, vertical farming, automation. So these are the major focused areas, and then related to it, we have different institute and research externally funded projects are there in which we have been working at Indian Agriculture Research Institute. As I told you that this structure is particularly owned by the farmers, naturally ventilated greenhouse. You can see in the picture, it's a 500 square meter, very simple structure. And outside it, there is a low pressure drip irrigation, which works almost on zero energy. So in this type of gravitation-based drip irrigation, you do not need any energy for working on it. In the tanks visible in the picture, in the same tank, we add water-soluble fertilizers. And then there is a valves and filters, which when open and closed according to the crop demand. So you can see inside the greenhouse, we are taking in one portion tomato and in one portion colored capsicum. So this is a very common structure, and most of the farmers are using it in the different parts of the country for growing lots of horticulture crops. The problem is that this structure has limitation when you have extreme summer. Then because there is no cooling inside it, then there is a problem. Otherwise, even in Delhi condition, 9 to 10 months, it works very satisfactorily. Then, as I told you, these are the few some latest designs that we have done, that greenhouse nursery, net house, and greenhouse. So in greenhouse, the design things, as I told you, how to maximize the ventilation. That is the very important thing. So there are all mathematical formulas and models are there to calculate the ventilation. Ventilation we require for the ventilation for top, ventilation from side. How to do the maximum ventilation and stabilize the structures. So this is one of the very guiding principle of design of structures. On the basis of it, we have designed different, these are the structures designed at IERI and then very commonly used by other stakeholders. Some advanced protected cultivation modules, which you can say that pure soilless cultivation, hydroponics, or nowadays vertical farming, in which we are taking the crops in multiple layers with the help of artificial light. So these are the latest research now that we are also doing. And fortunately, we have some very good project also to build this type of specialized vertical farming models, in which the major technology is basically soilless, hydroponics, and aeroponics. And then we have to use, of course, artificial light to grow the crop inside it. See, this is a very, very interesting slide. Please, you can see that this is the very innovative model that we have developed at our farm. You can see that in the entire 25-acre farm, all the water, especially the runoff water being generated from the rooftop of the protected structures and our open field also. You can see in the background that from the greenhouse top, all the gutters are there in which we have converted the connected into the lateral drains, and all the water, runoff water, which generated immediately after the runoff, because the greenhouse top is pure plastic. So immediately the runoff starts, even with few rains. And these all rains, we have we try to store the rainwater in different types of reservoir. You can see that there is a special reservoir that is the geomembrane lined reservoir. Then we have RCC reservoir. And also we have unlined reservoir used for groundwater recharge. So three models of water harvesting we have made. In the picture, there are two are visible. And then all the waters are, rainwater are coming into it. We are trying to collect the water and then reuse that water with modern irrigation method, whether it is sprinkler or drip. So this is the thing that how we first collect the rainwater and then reuse that water. Many farmers are doing very good work on this line and doing good work to collect the water and reuse that water, making the protected cultivation module sustainable in terms of water. Then these are the some modern machines we are using for fertigation management. We have very specialized filtration machine, which can, this particular spin clean disc filtration machine, this can handle even a small river to clean the water, especially to get rid of major suspended impurities. And then we are using lots of fertigation controller for automation, especially to do the automation and control the fertigation of different parts of this. We have developed one indigenous irrigation scheduler also with the help of one DST project. We have taken the help of CDAC, Mohali, and then developed this particular indigenous irrigation controller. These are the machines mostly used for the automation and also for fertigation management in protected cultivation. Then, as I told you that in automatic drip fertigation method for we are using, especially in all our farms, where there is a dedicated fertigation controller unit, and then specialized fertigation field layout, some solar power fertigation also we are doing, and try to use collectively this model so that it helps in overall saving of water and saving of nutrient also in protected cultivation. What we have found, that you can see that in this data, that there is a clear cut advantage that if you take a particular crop, say tomato, when you grow this crop in open field with surface irrigation, you get the crop water productivity only around 12 kilogram per meter cube. And you see, if you use same crop in the semi-climate controlled greenhouse with the drip irrigation, you can see there is almost 7 times increase. The crop water productivity goes 80 kilogram per meter cube. It is possible only that we get high production and use less water. So the productivity is yield per unit use of water. So when we have high yield and less water, there is a clear-cut jump. You can see that in the picture, that this is only to show one particular crop, that there is a clear-cut advantage of using greenhouse for increase the crop water productivity. A lot of sensors we are using for protected cultivation sensor, whether it is soil moisture sensor, fertigation sensor, climatic sensor, disease monitoring sensor, we have very few. Nutrition deficiency sensor, they are very costly, still we have to import. Food quality sensors are also costly. So mostly most of the sensors, you can see that some sensors are available in our country. They are cheap. They are being used now also by the growers, but not all. Many sensors are still very costly. And especially if you take the sensor and to be used in for automation, then sometimes the sensors are very, very costly.
Dr. Hassan, sorry. interrupt? Yes. Another couple of minutes, if you can.
Yes, yes, wind
up a little bit. Thank you.
See now, we are evaluating different sensors for greenhouse crop water productivity. You can see that, say, the crop is chrysanthemum, in which we evaluated the things. These are the grow bag and container soilless system based greenhouse, in which in the greenhouse we are taking the crops totally without soil. You can say that is the grow bag technology, totally soilless media based technology. Then this is the latest research that we have developed, designed the indigenous model of aeroponic system, in which the crops are being hanging in the air and we spray the crops the water and nutrition. We have done its complete automation, and recently we have developed the IoT modules for it also. This is the pure hydroponic model. You can see that in which in pure water culture we grow the crop. Some bulletins we have developed especially for Hindi and English for the farmers also, and these are available free in Google. Some technical bulletins on hydroponics and all these things. Coming to the very important slide, that is the technological. What are the technological and policy issues required? See, what we required: indigenous models and designs as per the agroclimatic zones and farmers' requirement. It is very necessary because in many parts of the country there is still no standard designs being followed. So, as an engineer, we require very concerted efforts to develop this type of models and designs. We need sensors, IoT, and automation-based greenhouse technology. Still, we are importing the things, and many projects are going on to develop these things. I hope that in the coming year, it will be more easily accessible. Then I have already told that we need vertical farming models linked with protected cultivation technology based on hydroponics as well as aeroponics. Demonstrations and trainings related to various experts are required by the farmers, because many farmers in many parts of the country, they require specialized trainings. Then finally, for the success of the models, what we have found in our experience, that individually protected cultivation is not successful. They are successful only when we have the cluster approach and there are FPO based business models. So these things are very important to have successful models as entrepreneurship development for the farmers. So whenever there is a cluster of things, we found that it is very good. And also the FPO, there are many FPOs are doing very good work. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Murtaza. I think next I would like to invite Mr. Shrinu Sharma. I would request Murtaza Hasan to also introduce.